Well, it's finally here. Sonic's 31st birthday gift. If you want a video talking about the game's glitches and complaining about cash grabs, then this isn't gonna be it. My only interest right now is the lore implications of this title. Sonic Origins is a collection of remakes for Sonic's 1, CD, 2, 3, and Knuckles, which puts some deep holes into my timeline, as well as the timelines for a lot of other people I've spoken to. So let's go through, game by game, and discuss the changes made to each title in this collection, and what they mean going forward. However, we won't talk about Sonic 3 and Knuckles in this video, because that game has yet to get its own deepest lore episode. We'll cover that duology in its own video. Now, for all of these games, the most important change is going to be the opening and closing cutscenes that were added. In Sonic 1, the opening doesn't really do much to change anything. More or less, it just shows Sonic wandering across a crime scene and deciding to do something about it, which puts it pretty well in line with how Sonic probably acts on a day-to-day basis. The closing cutscene is the one worth talking about, however. While obviously Sonic didn't have the emeralds at the start of Sonic 2, this shows he didn't just get rid of them himself. They just up and left. Interestingly, they also grant Sonic a vision of the 7th missing Chaos Emerald, confirming that Sonic only had access to 6 at this point, and that the 7th remains trapped on West Side Island, which is also in line with the previous canon. Despite Sonic Origins adding a new intro and outro, the ones that came with the original Sonic CD are still canon. The new Sonic Origins scenes actually sandwich rather well on the outside of the already existing events of CD. The new intro happens just before the old one, and the new outro happens after the old outro. Simple as that. That said, Origins also confirms the theorized placement of CD as being between Sonic 1 and Sonic 2, so take that, naysayers. First, we see Amy telling her own future with tarot cards. Now, this is a bit of a little-known fact, but Amy has always been associated with tarot ever since CD's initial release, and one of the reasons she's so obsessed is because the tarot told her that he was her destined lover. Here, we see that fateful card come to play, but only after Amy tried to mess with fate a little bit. So maybe that reading isn't quite as sound as she believed. I just enjoy the fact that we now have an actual showing of Amy's tarot skills in a game that's not Sonic Chronicles, and I hope they find a way to involve magic in her character more going forward. The ending cutscene shows us that Sonic has the tornado. Many fans mistakenly believe that this plane belongs to Tails, as he's the one who's always seen flying it. However, in canon, the tornado has always belonged to Sonic. So it's nice to see that cemented for us in a game. We also see Amy back with her tarot cards, seemingly predicting the events of Sonic 2, with both a card showing 2 Tails, and another showing the final Chaos Emerald, both of which representing things first introduced in Sonic 2. Now, this game is by far the most important to us, lore-wise. For the most part, it seems to cover the backstory between Sonic and Tails as told in the original Sonic 2 manual. Tails is being bullied for having 2 Tails. He idolizes Sonic, and the fox starts to follow the hedgehog in order to learn to be more like him and start to believe in himself. We see Tails using his tails to keep speed with the blue blur. But at the end of the scene, we see something even more interesting. He starts to fly. Of course, if you know anything about him, this doesn't come as a surprise. But when you think about it, things start to get a little weird. Tails apparently learns to fly right before he and Sonic wind up in Emerald Hill Zone, which means that the two of them pretty much met just before the events of Sonic 2. So, 2 Game Gear, Sonic Chaos, and plenty of other games just can't fit in that time frame anymore, and I need to find new locations for them. Not only that, but the fact that Tails learned to fly only after meeting Sonic directly contradicts Tails' adventure, which, according to the manual, occurred long before Sonic and Tails even knew each other, and also feature Tails flying as a gameplay mechanic. This one cutscene seems to decanonize that game entirely. And honestly, this decanonization is a real shame. While the game itself didn't age the best, it brought forth the idea of the Chaos Emeralds being sealed away for centuries before the events of that game, and led to a lot of interesting discussion about the history of the Emeralds. But all of that seems moot now. I'm not sure if I'll give Tails Adventure its own video at some point, since it's non-canon now, but I will be sorely missing the lore that it once gave us. The ending cutscene shows the Death Egg crashing down onto Angel Island, and leads directly into the Sonic 3 opening video. One other game that's worth bringing up here, and was honestly a huge shock to all of us, is the menu for story mode in Origins. It shows the Vego Fortress from Sonic Spinball. Why would they do this? That game isn't related to this one at all. But I think the answer is clear. Spinball is one game often dismissed as canon because of its connections to Sonic Sad AM, and the appearances of the Freedom Fighters, something I mentioned in one of my previous Archie Sonic videos. Its appearance here, literally linked to story mode, implies that Spinball is in fact part of the story, and should be treated as canon. No, this doesn't mean Freedom Fighters canon, Son Alley, everyone's cheers. I've had some long talks about that with some other like-minded Sonic lore people, and I need to look more into the lore of this game in general to see what the actual implications would be. It also means I need to play this damn game, and that doesn't make me happy. I'll do a video about it eventually, but probably not until after I get around to that Sonic 3 and Knuckles episode, so keep an eye out for that sometime in the future, I guess. Also, while Tails Adventure is the only game that's for sure been decanonized by Origins, part of my brain has been asking me if that's the only one. I'm going to have to keep a closer eye out for discrepancies going forward, but part of my initial reaction to this Tails Adventure realization was adding a lot more games to the decanonized list. I'll let all of you know if I find more games that just don't work with what was presented in Origins. All that taken together, the question is, what now? Where does this leave our timeline? After decanonizing Tails Adventure and re-canonizing Spinball, we also know that my original placement of Sonic 2 Game Gear and Sonic Chaos are incorrect, both due to the Sonic 1 ending and Sonic 2 opening from Origins. We see that there's no room for Sonic and Tails to have adventures together before Sonic 2. Instead, those events need to be moved until after the events of Sonic 2 and 3. It also means that I can't use the 6 Chaos Emerald argument for timeline placement. At this point, our timeline will change from this to this, just shifting a couple of Game Gear titles. But this also throws my entire late classic era timeline out of whack. I'll need to spend some time building my full new timeline. But for now, this is where Sonic Origins leaves us. As I mentioned earlier, our next Sonic game video will be about Sonic 3 and Knuckles, which I know I've been promising since March. I'm sorry, it's coming. Until then, check back next week for another Metroid 2 video. Or more accurately, the deepest lore of Samus Returns. If you have other videos you want to see, whether they be about specific games, series, or just discussion topics, let me know in the comments. Also, be sure to keep the conversation going down there. I've been loving what I've been seeing in those comments the past few weeks. Thanks for watching, and I'll see all of you next time. Goodbye.